Good morning. Welcome to worship. We're really glad you're joining us today. June is Pride Month. It is the month that the LGBTQ community celebrates with energy and gratitude all that God has created the LGBTQ people to be. At Peace, we celebrate too. We celebrate that on December 16th, 2018, we became a reconciled in Christ congregation, which means we welcome all who are seeking God's love and grace. We welcome all because God welcomes all, regardless of race or culture, sexual orientation, gender identity, gender expression, or relationship status. We welcome all without regard to addictions, physical or mental health, imprisonment, socioeconomic circumstances, or anything else that too often divides us. We recognize that our unity is in Christ. Thank you for making this church a place of inclusion. Thank you for raising enough money to call a youth and family leader who can walk alongside all of our youth as they find their way forward. Thank you for making Christ known with love and compassion for all people. Today, I introduce you to Caleb. He is one of the high school students participating in Brunch Bunch, who shares a bit of his journey with us. Again, thank you so much for joining us for worship today. We're glad you're here.
My name is Caleb Connors. I'm 15 and I identify as gay. It was important for me to have a faith-based LGBTQ support group because I think that the history of the church and just Christianity in general with the LGBTQ community is kind of messy. And I just wanted something that would, you know, bring those two topics together and for there to be a place where Christians could talk about those kinds of issues. Brunch Bunch made a difference in my life because it did really open my eyes to see that there are so many people that are, you know, accepting and that are a part of the community at church and that are all Christians. I hope to gain a general sense of community and acceptance at the church and, you know, recognition of the LGBTQ community at church, and that more people are more open to the idea of there being, you know, gay people at a church. I would say to other youth that might feel that they're a part of the LGBTQ community but are apprehensive, find your people, find friends. If you can, open up to your family, but friends for me were the most important people when I was trying to figure it out and trying to tell my family. And I would say that finding just your group and your community is going to help you feel more comfortable and open up more to your family and friends and everybody eventually. And, you know, you don't have to come out right away. You can come out in, you know, a year if you want to, 2 years, 3 years, you know, whenever you want. You know, there's no time that you have to be out by. There's just, you know, you just need to come out and tell people when you're ready. And if you're not ready, there's always tons of people at church or your friends or your family that are willing to help you if you're not willing to be super public about it.
I will come to you in the silence. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and one another. Gracious God, have mercy on us. We confess that we have turned from you and have lived in brokenness and despair. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things we have done and things we have failed to do. Turn us again to you and uphold us by your Spirit, so that we may live and serve you in the newness of life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Now, God, who is rich in mercy and loves us and makes us alive in Christ, in the name of Jesus, your sins are forgiven. May Almighty God strengthen you with the power through the Holy Spirit and move you forward in Christ's love and mercy. Amen.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Feast of victory for our God. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Worthy is Christ the Lamb who was slain, whose blood set us free to be people of God. This is the feast of victory for our God. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Power, riches, wisdom, and strength, and honor, blessing, and glory are His. This is the feast of victory for our God. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Sing with all the people of God and join in the hymn of our creation. Blessing, honor, glory, and might be to God and the Lamb forever. Amen. This is the feast of victory for our God. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. For the Lamb who was slain has begun his reign. Alleluia. This is the feast of victory for our God. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
The prayer of the day. Let us pray. O God, you direct our lives by your grace, and your words of justice and mercy reshape the world. Mold us into a people who welcome your word and serve one another. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Good morning. The first lesson comes from Jeremiah, the 28th chapter. Then the prophet Jeremiah spoke to the prophet Hananiah in the presence of the priests and all the people who were standing in the house of the Lord. And the prophet Jeremiah said, "Amen. May the Lord do so. May the Lord fulfill the words that you have prophesied and bring back to this place from Babylon the vessels of the house of the Lord and all the exiles. But listen now to this word that I speak in your hearing and in the hearing of all the people. The prophets who preceded you and me from ancient times prophesied war, famine, and pestilence against many countries and great kingdoms. As for the prophet who prophesies peace, when the word of that prophet comes true, then it will be known that the prophet has truly sent the prophet." Here ends the first reading. The second reading is the Holy Gospel, and so please rise if you are able, wherever you are. The Holy Gospel for this day comes from St. Matthew, the 10th chapter. Jesus says, "Whoever welcomes you welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me. Whoever welcomes a prophet in the name of a prophet will receive a prophet's reward, and whoever welcomes a righteous person in the name of a righteous person will receive the reward of the righteous. And whoever gives even a cup of cold water to one of these little ones in the name of a disciple, truly I tell you, none of these will lose their reward." The Gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen. Grace and peace to you from the triune God who has created us, redeemed us, and continues at each and every moment to sustain us in our lives of faith. Amen. Whoever welcomes you welcomes me, Jesus says. And that is where we begin. Notice the you in that opening line. Notice the role you play in being Christ in the world. Whoever welcomes you welcomes me, Jesus says. Powerful opening words in this text today. The exegesis, that is the research of this text, tells us that the you in that first line is plural, that it represents all of you as a singular you, and a singular you as all of you, which means that wherever any of you go, wherever you are welcomed, Christ is welcomed too, as well as the whole nature of the triune God. Rolf Jacobson, a professor at Luther Seminary, pointed out this week that Don Jewell, the late Don Jewell, a biblical scholar and a beloved professor, who I also took every class I could from, says that too often when we hear a text like this, we ask the text, what does this tell us to do? Instead, he said, we should be asking the text, what does this mean? So what do we hear when we hear Jesus say, whoever welcomes you welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me? Put in that perspective, I hear grace, I hear inclusion, I hear hope, I hear value, I hear opportunity, I hear possibility. And as I hear, I see how this works in the world that we live in. Whoever welcomes you welcomes me, Jesus says. When we are welcomed, we bring Jesus. When we are welcomed, we bring Christ's love. When we are welcomed, we not only bring it, we become it. Wow. So what does that mean? It means that when we are a welcoming church, a welcoming community, we welcome Jesus and the opportunity for love to become us. It means that when we go out into the world and are welcomed by others, friends, family, neighbors, or strangers, God's love is on the loose among us. It is a powerful image of the light and hope, the grace and mercy, the all-consuming, unconditional love of God in Christ Jesus finding its way into the world. But what does that look like? It was 1987, a long time ago. I had just finished my first master's degree in counseling and had found my first position that required it at Family and Children's Services in downtown Minneapolis. Doug had started seminary at Luther in St. Paul. We were only a few months out from our daughter Emily's death, and neither of us had ever lived in an urban setting before. We were young. I was young. I had lived most of my life up until that point in a town a little larger than Waunakee with a mostly Caucasian population. The position I had been offered was with a progressive nonprofit organization that served not only families and children, but the LGBTQ community. The organization also offered a prostitution recovery program. I cannot imagine why they hired me. I cannot imagine how they thought I would be effective in such work. But there I was in this job in which I was greener than green. greener than this stool. One of the first days at lunch, a colleague, a Jewish woman who was a lesbian, knowing that my husband was a seminary student, asked me what my religion proclaimed about homosexuality. I had no idea, and so I told her so. I went home and asked Doug. He had no idea. I asked pastor friends. I learned. I read. I went back to work. The woman who had asked me had welcomed me. She was curious about what Lutheran Christians believed and proclaimed. She was hoping against hope that somehow it included her, that somehow God's grace and love and mercy included her. In 1987, Lutheran Christians did not include her. In 1987 and 1988 and 1989 and for 20 more years, we would not see or recognize LGBTQ persons as fully vested members in the body of Christ in this church. They could be members, and we would serve them Holy Communion, and we would say that they were included in all of Christ's love and promise, except that we wouldn't ordain them, and we wouldn't bless them, and we wouldn't marry them. And so for all practical purposes, we had a double standard. In 2009, we changed that. But up until that moment, our position hurt people. It hurt the woman I worked with. It hurt some of the other folks I worked with. It hurt countless others with a message that because of their sexual orientation, they had fallen beyond the inclusion of God's love and mercy in the church. I say in the church because I want to be clear that LGBTQ people were never, not ever, beyond God's love and mercy. So when we realized that in 2009, we became an inclusive church. It was a stunning decision that had been way too long in coming. In 2009, my mom asked me what I thought about the church's decision. I told her exactly that it was stunning and beautiful and had taken way too long to become a reality. I was really surprised that she had asked me. She usually did not want to talk anything theological with me. My dad would do that, but not my mom, except he was no longer living and she was curious. She told me that her friends were really against it and angry and thinking about leaving their congregations. I told her why I believed what I believed. 2 years later, my mom was dying. She was afraid. She didn't think she was included in God's love for some reason, and I could not imagine what she was afraid of. A lifelong woman of faith who had served on every committee at the church, who was one of the first female council presidents in a very large congregation and had taught Sunday school, actually had run a Sunday school program for over 500 kids as a side job, for she was a full-time nurse during the week. She was afraid, for some reason, that she wasn't included in God's promise. Huh. I was stumped. Her pastor was stumped. I asked questions. I never got to the answer. I watched her dying with a fear so great that I felt totally helpless. It was a few weeks after her death that my sister discovered the pictures. It was a few weeks after her death that my sister and I realized the cause of the pain of our mom's life. She had been in love with a young woman, as a young woman, with another woman. And although she had lived almost all of her adult life as if that had not been true, which was its own sad truth, it was the very thing we suspected that made her so afraid of being outside of God's inclusive promise. Whoever welcomes you welcomes me, Jesus says. And whoever welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me. Those are Jesus' words. They include you. Whoever you are, this very day in the promise of Jesus, here and now, and forever and always, you are included. Amen.
Continue with the Apostles' Creed, and as we've been doing, we're going through it one article at a time, and we're on article number 3. So we'll say the third article, and we'll say the meaning for it, and then we'll go back and we'll confess the whole creed together. And it goes as follows. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And the meaning. I believe that I cannot, by my own understanding or effort, believe in Jesus Christ, my Lord, or come to him. But the Holy Spirit has called me through the gospel, enlightened me with his gifts, and sanctified and kept me in the one true faith. In the same way, he calls, gathers, enlightens, and sanctifies the whole Christian church on earth, and keeps it united with Jesus Christ and the one true faith. In this Christian church, day after day, he fully forgives my sins and the sins of all believers. On the last day, he will raise me and all the dead and give me and all believers in Christ eternal life. This is most certainly true. And now let's confess together the creed in its entirety. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Please join me in praying the prayers of the people. Gracious God, it is an uncertain time in our world. The violence in medicine this week gave us pause. Help us know what to do. Work with us. Help us find a way forward that is filled with love, compassion, justice, and peace for all people, especially our black and brown and rainbow-colored brothers and sisters who have suffered more than we know. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious Lord, you have empowered us to see that your gospel, the good news that came in Jesus, is for all people. Whoever welcomes you welcomes me. We give thanks that our community is a reconciled in Christ congregation, and the whole beautiful, inclusive, colorful rainbow of humanity are welcome here. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Holy God, we pray for all of our leaders, that they might guide the people of this world with truth, honor, and the kind of power that respects and strives to improve the life of every human being on the planet. Move them to mend with mercy the sins of our history, and empower them to act with liberty and justice for all people, all the time. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Healer of our every ill, we have people among us who are challenged with physical health and or mental health concerns. Help them in whatever ways they are needing your healing power. Hold them close enough to feel the pulse of your resurrected life. Surround them and carry them to healing in whatever way is possible. We pause for a moment of silence as we name them in the quiet of our hearts or out loud in our living rooms. Please bring your healing power to bear upon these lives. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious Lord, in the season of growing, may there be enough produce created to feed all people, and may it be distributed in ways that serve those who are the most hungry. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of us all, help us understand our place in the world. Help us realize that we are called to act with justice and mercy for the sake of the vulnerable, the oppressed, and the mighty. Help us remember that we promised, as members of the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America, to strive for peace and justice for all people in our world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of grace and love, this is a hard time to be a disciple. We are being called to make amends for the past and present in ways we didn't even understand until recently. Help us not hide in our fear, or our frustration, or our despair. Help us be moved with mercy to mend all that is broken with your love. And help us to see how we can individually contribute to a future that is grounded in your grace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of life and love, we are yours. May we work with you, for you, and with our human kin all over the world to create a vibrant future. Empower us to make this so. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Please join me in praying the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
I'd like to invite all the children forward for the children's message. Thank you all for coming up. Oh, that's right, you're not here. So how do we welcome when we're not all together? Oh, I think I've got it. What we do is we come out into the world, Each of us can do that in our own little places. And we all have gifts and things that we can do to share God's grace with the world, to share God's love with the world. So we give thanks for that. And why don't we have a prayer at this point? So, good morning, God. Thank you. Thank you for us. Thank you for your world. Thank you for the ways that you can use each of us and all of our gifts to make a difference out in the world. Keep us safe. Help us to show your love and grace with all the people around us. In your name we pray. Amen. And all God's people say, Amen.
Receive the benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord's face shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace. Serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Satisfied, I will give my life to them. shall.